Hello, everybody, and welcome to another episode of Hashtag Ask Jochen. For those of you who are new here, this is the live stream lecture that we do every month. So we do two live streams per month with Jochen. One is a Q&A where we answer all of your questions, and the other is a live stream lecture. So this one is the lecture, and this month's topic is the history, facts, and myths of saddle fitting to the rider. So it's going to be an excellent episode we have for you today. If you're tuning in on Facebook or YouTube, just please let us know where you're tuning in from. We'd love to connect with you guys and let us know if you have any questions about the topic. We will take them in the next episode in a couple weeks. So we're now ready to just move forward with our introduction. Then we can welcome Jochen into the session today. Welcome, Jochen.
Hello, Mary-Claire. How are you?
I'm great. How are you?
Good, good, good. This is an exciting topic for all of us, I guess. And I hope you find it as interesting as I did when I was researching it. Question, do you see the top bar where it says mute, show video, participants?
No, I don't see any of that. I just see the full screen, yeah.
Because part of it covers on my screen here the slides, and I want to make sure our audience gets everything we got to share today.
Awesome.
So without further ado, what's the answers I got when I looked into it? Well, let's look at the history. Let's drum it nice and loud like the soldier did here on his horse with his drums. The history to presents. Saddles made by men for men for thousands of years. But since 1978, most riders are female. And they're still right at saddles, mainly made by men for men. So we had a lot of opinions out there, and they're often formed by people who know the how, but they don't really look into the why that happened. You know, why have men made saddles for men? And why are we dealing with today's situation? So if we look at the, here's a little... the German Wehrmacht, the cavalry from Germany, they had a handbook. You know, they needed to learn exactly what part of a saddle goes where, on what horse, what's the name for it. And on the right, you see the saddle is a saddle that completely comes apart. As a matter of fact, when I started in 1978, that's 44 years ago, I worked for a company that was over 150 years old, and they made 2,000 of those saddles to a cavalry in Chile. And this saddle here, you can completely take apart everything. You can debill itself. You can take the flap off. You can take the panel off. And on the bottom of the panel is a serge in linen. So the rider could actually go in here and manipulate the horse hair or husk or sheepskin, whatever they prefer to use, to move it around so we got a perfect fit for the horse. But what about the rider? You see these little studs right there, and there's one on the seats. You could easily undo the whole seat, and the whole seat just peeled right off, right there where the soldier has his hands. You could take the saddle right off. So it was really, really, really easy for the rider to position the deepest points of the seat over the correct spot of the horse. Because you don't want to sit in the chair seat, you don't want to sit too far forward, or you don't want to sit back. You want to have the perfect balanced seat. So what is a perfect balanced seat? You know, so first we looked into it and says, where should the saddle sit? And what's the best for the horse? And of course, I got my answers looking through professionals such as these superstars. They are dedicated their life to find the answers to make sure that the horse does not suffer any pain. So once you look at the physiology and the anatomy of the horse, we got to look at the anatomy and physiology of the rider. So back then, here you see a soldier learning to map the horse. Very, very nice. You can see here in this picture, I hope you can see my mouse. This is what they call the ring of light. Okay, so that was a very important part. So here there were made sure when, even if the saddle extended there, that they moved with the awl, the husk or the horsehair in the panel forward. No pressure could be in the ring of light and no pressure could be where the mane ends forward. Like I saw, showed you in the picture from the drum saddle. Sometimes they had drums up that area, but that was always made sure that there is no pressure on the front of the shoulder or in that lumbar area, ring of lights. So here you see a soldier mapping the horse's back. Here's the picture from the German cavalry. You have to really use your imagination. What is that? But what you see here in 1949, this is all horses and humans together. So you see the guys holding the horses. So horse by horse by horse by horse, butt to butt to butt. Look at this. Okay, so this is a close-up how these horses are all have their saddles on. And they look all the same, same height, same color. So what I'm trying to say to you is it was much easier saddle fitting to horses because they had particular selected horses what look the same. So it's easier to fit their saddles and keep it united. So then they had a blanket. You see here the wool blanket. Here's the saddle now on the horse. And they, of course, was teaching the right seat, shoulder, hips, and heels. So they have in their books strict instruction how to not only put the bridle on the horse, the blanket, the girth, the saddle, also how to sit. In order to sit correctly, they needed to know how to fit the rider. And just like they selected the horses, they selected a certain type of rider. Not everybody could go to cavalry. If you're extremely tall or extremely small, you didn't fit in that perfect picture. Same like they selected the certain type of horses, they selected certain type of riders. Then what happens to our seat, the evolution of our seat? What is the correct seat? Leaning forward, you know, is it the upright seat? Is it the tucked seat or the full postural seat? You know, there's many, many different opinions how we have to sit in the saddle. But in the end of the day, you know, it's not like this. This is not, definitely not what we want to sit in the saddle. It is very, very painful for your back and long-term also for the horse. So if we have pain in the crotch, the rider will scoop away from it. If the saddle makes you slouch like this over the long run, not only you deform in your spine, but also the horse cannot handle all the pressure there. Certain sports for a certain moment, if you want to choose to ride like this, or just go on the beach, have fun and ride like this and swim, nothing wrong if it's just once or twice. But every day riding like this one here is not good. Your spine is not meant to sit on the chair like that. Yes, we have chairs, but those chairs don't hop up and down. And when we sit on the chair, we sit on our seat bone, like you see on the bottom right here. So in order to find the right seat bone width, right, we need to determine, do we fit now, like in the old days, just the riders to certain type of riders are allowed to ride? No. You know, back then when female were riding, they were riding in side saddles. I mean, you can go as far back as you want. However, my point, what I'm trying to do, as I said in the first couple of slides, over thousands of years, men make saddles for men. And even though we have the majority of the rider now females, female still ride saddles made by men for men. And we know for a fact that the male pelvis cannot bear children. A female pelvis is made for this, no matter what type of the four different pelvic anatomies are present. You know, I'm going to go into this a little bit more in detail because there is not just one particular female pelvis, but there is a big difference between the male pelvis and the female pelvis. Okay, and those are nine differences. So the myth of there is no difference between a male and female saddle, you ought to ask yourself that question. Is that true? Is there really no difference? Even though there are nine different massive features between the male and female anatomy of the pelvis and legs. So let's think about this through, and let's think about what medical doctors write. You know, I sure did not go to medical school, but I am surrounded myself with much more people who know much more than I do. So when medical doctor write about the rightest pain, or if you desire a pain-free back, there's a reason why Dr. Worsen puts a male and female pelvis on the front cover. My book, Suffering in Silence, which I undertitled the saddle fit linked to the physical and psychological trauma in horses, but also for riders. If the rider doesn't sit quiet, you will never have a quiet seat. So if you don't have a quiet seat, then the horse will suffer. Now you clearly see on the left side how the male short hips and heels, just like the old cavalry was teaching, okay? The seat bones are closer to the horse in the rear by the male. We have a butt cheek closer, and we also have the difference in the females. They have more curvature in the back. I show you the different curvature in different countries in a minute, but all female, no matter what female pelvis you have a shorter tailbone. And therefore, because of those two characteristics, you have different area where your buttocks is, your gluteus maximus. Okay, you can see there's more space. So if this body sits in the saddle, what's made for a male, the rider will sit like in the brown saddle. She will fall back because there's no support, rather than this lady who rides in the female saddle, what sits properly over the leg. Here you can see different countries, you know, in the Japanese pelvis, it's a little bit more straighter. European have a little bit more of a lower curvature, and desirable as a rider, we want kind of something in the middle. Here the different pelvises, you know, how they can tilt, one can tilt more forward than the other. The differences in the four different female pelvises, this area here, this is the birth channel, the inlet, okay? Looks all different, but you can also see how it makes a difference on the seat bones. So when we measure rider today, it's not just the normal average seat. We need to know how is your pelvis and how does it align with your pubic symphysis and your iliac crest. So we do not want to sit like this. We don't want to tilt back, and we want to make sure we do not tilt in our disc down here, because then eventually end up with slipped disc, and that's very painful. So you don't want to sit like that or like this. That is only long-term pain. We want to sit nice and straight and not falling left to the right. So that's very often considered the rider has a standing seat, just like this gentleman here, or the lady, I should say, standing. The only difference between riding and standing is standing, your weight is in your feet. Sitting is in your, well, on your seat bones, but your feet should be underneath, so you have a natural pelvis position. We want to sit on the balance point of the horse. We don't want to fall left or right. And we want to sit over the right point of the horse. I don't want to sit too far back and not too far forward. My sternum need to align with the horse's sternum. Only then I sit in harmony with shoulder, hips, and heels. And I always visualize I'm sitting on the horse like I'm sitting on a barrel that floats down the river. If I sit too far forward in the barrel or too far back, I fall back or forward. If I sit too far left or right, I fall in the water. So just like that, the balance seat can only be created if I measure my pelvis, okay? So I need to know, even if I'm a female, yeah, I'm gonna go with a female saddle. We need to know the difference between your upper leg and lower leg, the hip circumference, the thigh circumference. That will determine very, very fast what type of seat it needs to be fitted for you. You could also be measured sitting in sapphire. Sapphire is the beanbag where we suck the air out, and then we know exactly where your seat bones are and the curvature. On the left is the female. You can see it's a much flatter open seat. On the male, seat bones are much deeper in the back and we can see a different curvature, more like a very sharp V, more like an open U. And there's measurements you can do with sitting on cardboard, like in the bicycle industry. Look at number three. They can then give you, basically, after you sit on cardboard, it makes indent like you see here. They can then tell if you need a 13-inch seat, 14-inch seat, 15, 16, 17-inch seat. So in other sports where saddles are used, like the bicycle seat, there they can use already certain ways how to measure your seat bones. In our industry, we at Schleese, we use computerized saddle pads. That's not just for the horse, but also for the rider. So we can even see where you move in motion. And as I always said, we need to fit the rider in movement. We measure standing static, but we need to fit for movement. So the other measurements we can take is the cast. This is probably the most accurate way of how we can measure. It's very easy, very fast, and we can take the measurement of the pelvis. So we can see clearly on the female pelvis, we have an indent in the front by the seat bone, and the guy's seat bones, like I showed you on the blue sapphire picture, sits further back. Here you can see the X-ray. There's another way how you can measure your pelvis. And in this way here picture, I'm just going to turn this off. So otherwise it's going to be too confusing. I let it run a little bit and you can see the different shapes here. This is corners where the seat bones are more in the back. Okay, right there. We're looking at how it's shaped through here. Very deep seat bones, very close together. And you can see by just looking at Connor's pelvis, look at Danielle's pelvis, how much flat it's through here. Okay, so if I compare that pelvis to that pelvis, you can see we will have a complete different view. And I'm going to speed that up a little bit. That's right here in that area. That's the first impact, what hits on the horse or on your saddle. And you want to sit, like I showed you before, in the center of the saddle, close to the horse's withers. You need the support as a female back there because of your shorter tailbone and higher pubic symphysis. You need more support as a lady in the back. So these are the different types of pelvises, how you can see the difference. Just like we can also measure the horse with, let me just turn this on here, turn that off. With a 3D camera, we can also scan the horse's back and see the back from the top. And we can also look from underneath inside. So we know exactly how to form your saddle. And the cool part is once we have your pelvis, we can do the same after you've done your cast over our long distance cast fitting kit we're working on right now, as well as our on-site cast. We are very easy to take our camera, take a picture, and then of course it figures it out exactly how we need to fit out the measurements. So you can see there is lots of technology out today, and we want to make sure that the rider sits in the center. Right? What center is this? You're looking at computerized saddle pad. It's nice and even pressure. And the center is here. You're looking at the horse from the bottom. This is the sternum plate. See how the ribs are wide to the back? So you don't want to sit here where the ribs are open. You want to sit close to the withers. If this is the saddle stand, I'm just going to put that to the side. Stop. Here we go. You want to sit in the midsection of that area. You don't want to sit in the back of the saddle or in the back of the horse's back because that's where all the ribs are open. Okay. This green area here is from a computerized saddle pad. That's in this area here. And you see no pressure on the spine, nothing on the triangle, that red triangle. Right. So we want to sit in that area. So here we have now the two pelvises on that stand. And you can see where I'm going to pause it when it comes to the side or from the bottom even. So here we go. So you can see, oops, that was not meant to do. Hang on. Here we go, one more time. So this is from the bottom. You can see how deep the seat bones are, how much deeper the saddle is built in the back for the male's pelvis. So I stop that right here. Nope, it keeps going. Gotta find the stop button on this thing. Okay, maybe it works like this better. There you go. So here you see the male cast on that saddle stand. The deepest point is definitely further back for the guy. So if we're going to compare that on the female cast, it's going upside down right now, bear with me. And here we go. So this is from the bottom, right? So this is the area where the shoulder rotates. You see this impression here, that's the front pubic symphysis. This is the lowest point. Clearly you see the impact of the female pelvis is way more forward when she rides on the horse. Here we go. You see, this is the second line. This is the deepest point right at the base of the withers. So it's absolutely crucial that you get measured, because if you don't, you will hit the crotch, or here's a good picture. Here's the pelvis in the saddle. You see how the pubic symphysis hits the pommel. And here is the guy, sits on the seat bone, and you have that freedom in the crotch, not only in the pubic symphysis and pubic branches, but also in your soft parts. So all guy saddles are built specific with a very steep roof in the crotch area, what I simulate down here, so that the male's part go left to right. No female wants to get the pressure into the crotch. You see the rider here, you will sit back. And if you do that, you will have an incorrect seat. And that means you have no pliable seat. You will have long-term damage to your back and the horses. Why? Because no rider can over long-term handle the pressure into the crotch or into the seat bones. You see the different angle of the pubic branches. Okay, these are all female pelvises, so that can be quite a bit different. Here took a picture out of the bicycle industry, how super careful they make sure that neither the girl or the boy have ever any pressure on the pubic symphysis. You don't want contact there. Clearly here you see much higher the pubic branches compared to the female. All right, so my encouragement is get measured, make sure you don't get into this hyperextension or hollow back. Okay, you will have long-term damage in the back, no matter what female pelvis you have. Okay, a male pelvis, the center balance is always in the center. Okay, the pelvis axis. All ladies have the pelvis axis more forward. All ladies have the seat bones in general wider than the male. And all ladies have a shorter tailbone. Okay, it's absolutely important that you have the proper saddle for the pelvis you are born with. Here a front view and here from the bottom, where you as a lady want to have your seat bone inside the dotted shaded out area. That's the seat form. You never want to feel like you're hanging over the edge. Okay, so the seat bone width must be wide enough to accommodate your seat bone width. We have one more part, what is absolutely important in measuring when it comes to the rider's pelvis. And keep in mind, in the back, we never needed to do that because we just looked at the soldier, the man, average height. It was classified, okay, that person is too small, that person is too tall, that person is too skinny, too heavy, whatever, only a certain type of people got selected to come in the cavalry. We did not back then, as humans had to deal with different pelvises or different thighs. Look at the difference between male and female. The muscular structure is different on the thigh versus on the female. Our bone in the neck of the femur goes much different. It's almost straight down, where a female has a more cone shape. It goes, the neck is much longer. Look how the femur goes in and then down. So in general, the lady has less space in that area between her upper inner thigh. Guys have more space. So obviously that makes a huge role how the saddle is built. That would be where your stirrup bar is. That would be where the side part of your thighs are. That could be very, very stressful for your, well, hips if you do not get your legs measured. In general, here one more time, the femur hangs straighter down on the femur. The femur comes in and then down. Of course, we got female pelvis with large Q angle. This is called Q angle. And we have ladies with a smaller Q angle. But keep in mind what I said before, both ladies, doesn't matter if you have a large or a small Q angle, you still have a childbearing pelvis, which has the shorter tailbone and your pelvis axis is forward. If I ignore the space between my upper inner thigh, okay, as I said, ladies in general has less space here than male, okay, that will put a lot of stress, not just on your hips, but also on your back, because your sciatic nerve runs inside your thigh, goes all the way to the lumbar, and then obviously the rest, the foot, the knee, the back, the joints, is just a matter of time when you say, oh, I cannot hold that anymore. And then, of course, you have no pliable seat. And if you don't have a pliable seat, it's very, very hard to sit soft to the horse. So all these dimensions here, which you see, are what I mentioned in the beginning of this slide. Super important that you fit your seat width. That's number one, right here, okay? As I said, lady wants wider. The bellies, this is a very important number here. The bellies is so important because that determines the measurements on your thigh. The twist, that's what I said just now, with how much space between your upper inner thigh. How large or small is your Q angle? The waist is how low or high is your pubic symphysis or your pubic branches, and so on and so forth. All these make a huge, huge difference. And that's why with all the technology we have today, if it's X-ray, it's a fiber optic camera, is it MRIs, is it taking cast, take it beanbag, there is now no more guessing to get the seat correct to the rider's mode and most important aid, which is your seat. Your seat is your most important aid. So if you have any of these problems from hip pain, seat bone pain, crotch pain, all the way back to leg being in front, feet going out, feet and legs moving too much, that is all if your twist, your seat dimension is incorrect. So I cannot stress enough, besides trying it on the horse and fit it to the horse, most likely the horse will change much faster his physique than you ever will. Most of the time when an adult is finished growing, there is not much more change in the pelvis unless you're just ready to give birth and had a childbirth, natural childbirth. Yes, your pelvis sounds horrible, but it separates in four areas, but it will come back together. Will it come back exactly the same like it was before, or even or uneven? Well, we don't know. Sometimes they do, sometimes they don't. But what I'm trying to bring across here, you should have none of these problems I'm showing here on the slides if your saddle fits you properly. So thank you very much for listening today to the historic facts and myths of the saddle fitting to the rider. If you want to learn more, check us out, the saddle. forwomen.com or at schleese.com. And I appreciate your time. And as always, thank you for joining. Spread the news. Share our videos. We love for you to do that. And I look forward to see you next time.